When I was searching out Christmas devotionals, this one came straight to the top, Simply Christmas, because it just perfectly captures our less doing, more meaning Christmas. So today we get to chat with the author, Tamma Fortner, and you are gonna love her and some of her tips for a simple Christmas.
Before you like formally introduce yourself, I want you to talk about what were you seeing that this book was a response to.
My kids are now college age. And so I think there's a little bit of perspective you get when you're not in the midst of things. And I looked back and I see the things that I'm so glad I did. And I see also so many things that I'm like, that was a waste of time. That effort to make everything perfect, to make it what other people said it should be, the holiday season, that from the food to the decorations to what my kids wore, even to the way we celebrated Jesus. And I just, over the years, learned some hard lessons about how to let go of that. And I wanted to kind of give moms today a shortcut, maybe. You know, here's what I learned. It's okay to say no to this so you can say yes to the things that matter to your family.
So you've walked through this.
Yes. Yeah. Yes. This is all hard learned lessons. So please don't ever think I got any answers the easy way.
Yes.
I probably flat on my face.
So. Well, so Tamma, just describe for us then by way of introduction, who's at home with you? What's a normal day like? And where does your writing fit into that?
So we are actually in a little bit of a season of transition. My youngest is now a sophomore in college. 2020 was his freshman year. It was a little weird. Yeah. So, you know, we're still figuring out how to do this empty nest thing, but it's myself, my husband, Jeff. We've been married for 23 years. My daughter is across town at Lipscomb University. My son is across in another state at Harding University. Now I have this luxury of actually getting to sit down every morning and write, which is wonderful. And also easy to find closets that need organizing instead of sitting down to write.
Well, and you know, Tamma, I feel like if there was maybe an overarching theme to this book specifically, it would be permission. Mm-hmm. I love how you shared a story about going to like a library reading time and how the librarian said that, what was it? Cut and serve cookies don't count, or slice and bake cookies don't count. Exactly. And I love that you said, like, you actually bought into that, mm-hmm. but then you had to course correct and be like, wait, no. So tell us a little bit about that journey and how I really do feel like permission might be a good word throughout the pages of this book to give us all permission to kind of step back from some of those expectations.
I tried to live that out, and you have little ones. So, you know, baking with little ones is not always the sunshine and roses in the photographs. and sometimes it could get so stressful but I pushed through because I thought this is what I have to do to be a good mom. And I still remember there was a point at which I realized, and it was actually another story I talk about in the book about my friend's gingerbread house, that I don't have to compete. I can do things my way. And as long as we end up with sugar cookies at the end of the day, it's all good. It doesn't matter if I spent hours with my kids making them from scratch. It doesn't matter if we dashed out to the bakery and grabbed some. The point is spending time with your kids, with your family, and doing that in a way that is as the least amount of stress as possible. Because when mom's stressed, it seeps down into the kids. And there's just so much pressure to do things a certain way.
And I think today more than ever, Tamma, comparison, because we see all of these perfect images around us. So how did you separate yourself from those expectations or that comparison? Was it just simply the realization like, this isn't working, we have to try a different way?
Yeah, just a couple of epic failures, you know. I remember looking at my kids and they were not happy. They were not having fun. And I'm thinking, why? You know, there's nobody watching this process. Nobody's going to know if I bake the cookies. Nobody's going to know if our gingerbread house leans 30 degrees to the left, you know. at some point, I just got to the point of like, okay, enough. There's got to be a different way. And a tragedy actually happened to a friend of ours right about that same time. They lost their daughter to cancer. And that was such a clarifying moment for me. Yeah. Like, I've got 18 years with these kids. Let's make the best of it that we can. And not to say that I didn't mess up epically every one of those 18 years at some point or another, but it really shifted our focus to what matters most.
And how did, speaking of what matters most, how did then your faith or even your pursuit of Jesus during this time then kind of shape these new values that you were stepping into?
There's this identity that we have, first in my career, then as a mom, and I really found my identity in those things. But as those things were stripped away, you know, I didn't really have the career anymore, although I did a little bit on the side. And then, you know, momhood is just kind of a series of mistakes and figuring it out as you go. That identity was not working. I had to find my identity in something else and in someone. And the more I discovered who I was in Christ, the more I discovered the things that made him happy, that it wasn't the perfection, that it wasn't the making my tree look like that one on the magazine cover or Pinterest, that it was seeking him, the more I was able to say no to some of the perfection and comparison. But it really does stem with him.
That's beautiful. And what are ways that you like to keep your faith or celebrate the real meaning of Christmas? What are some traditions or habits or ways that you intentionally look for that?
You know, there's a verse, and the reference just went out of my head, but it's Paul says, you know, in him, in God, we live and move and have our being. And that's something that my husband and I have tried to incorporate. So yes, we worship on Sundays, and yes, we do these specific things, but we really try to weave God into everything. So we're taking the kids shopping for, you know, the Christmas tree angel child, and we're helping them pick out, and we're talking about why we do these things. We are reading the actual Christmas story. I realized one time, wow, we're doing Christmas and I'm not reading the Christmas story. So we're actually reading the Christmas story. And there's a lot of conversations. I think conversations with your kids are so important. This is what we're doing and this is why, and he is why.
That's beautiful. And I just want to also explain kind of the format of the book, that you have this like beautiful devotion and like scriptural reference and thought to like ponder and let it kind of soak in your heart. And then the following page after each devotional is like a practical step that you can take to simplify your holiday and kind of remove yourself from some of the expectations. What are some of your favorite tips for just kind of stepping back and simplifying the holidays?
One of my favorite practical tips actually starts at the end of this season. When you box everything up, box it up according to room or according to area that you decorate, so that the next year you can just pull out one box at a time and don't destroy the whole house. Yeah. So also decide, you know, hey, 2020, I'm looking at you. I'm not up for decorating all these rooms. Totally. And that can just stay in the box. That's my favorite practical tip.
Yeah, that's really good.
The pondering tip, this sounds crazy. I love to lay down at night under the Christmas tree by myself and talk to God. Wow. And it sounds totally crazy, but you're looking up at all those beautiful lights. And I don't know, it centers me somehow.
I love that. And especially for a busy mom, you know, you almost have to physically put yourself in a place where, you know, under a tree, I love that you're free from distraction. You're kind of surrounded by the beauty of the season and the meaning. And even one of the first devotionals talks about light, how light was present all through the Christmas story and even today. And so I think that's so fun to have like a physical way of like entering into the season. And I feel like that would help kind of free our minds from distraction a little bit too.
It's its own little world and it's all sparkly and beautiful.
I love that. If the kids get to do it, why not us?
Exactly.
Okay, so let's just have fun, Tama. What are some of your favorite, just like stress-free gift ideas?
I am a huge fan of gift cards. I love getting them. And I think a lot of people do. I think they get a bad rap, but I like to make it kind of an experience. So for example, if I'm giving a movie gift card, I get one of those nice big popcorn buckets and I tuck in some candy and things. Uh-huh. Books, obviously, I'm a nerd. So I love to, you know, get a book and a mug and some hot chocolate and tuck in a, you know, a bookstore gift card. That's really my easy go-to. And, you know, for last minute gifts, you can hit the grocery store aisle and there's everything you need. There's a gift card, there's a mug, there's some candy, pop it together in a little bag and you can run out the door with that gift that you forgot to get for. So maybe that's just me.
Well, and what I actually think is a great idea this year too, I feel like if you were to take this devotional and put it with like a little tea, a little mug, a little journal, a little candle, you would have a gift for like $15. And I feel like if you give this gift preemptively, so like if you give it to a mom or girlfriend or, you know, women in your life, then you're kind of setting the tone of like, hey guys, like we're keeping this simple. Maybe return to me a favorite devotional or something that's going to help, you know, be meaningful in my life. And so I just feel like this, and it's a gift to them because you're helping them to simplify and connect with the Lord, you know, during this season. But I just feel like you're kind of setting the tone and you're like, hey, we're going to keep this simple. You then return the favor with a favorite devotional and a little, your favorite tea, you know, and just again, to kind of, you get ahead of the curve a little bit and to keep things nice and simple.
Oh, I love that idea, obviously.
Yes, buy it for everyone you know. Stock it for next year.
Sure, my head.
Tama, you have a great gift for us too if we sign up for your newsletter.
Yes, so I have just put together a study guide and journal that goes along with each day of the devotional. You can make it as quick or as in-depth as you want to, because I know our mom time varies so widely. But yeah, you just go to tamafortner.com, sign up for the newsletter, which is very occasional. And yeah, you'll get a free download.
I'll be sure to put that in the description so it's easy to find, because it's so beautiful. It'd be nice to have that place to write along with the prompts that you have in here. So I think that's such a great idea. Well, Tama, parting shots, encouragement, just what would you like to say in closing to, you know, all the moms out there who are getting ready for Christmas?
Oh, you know, just turn everything to God. Start that day with Him and forget about making everything perfect for what everyone else thinks and just try to make Him smile and it'll all be all right.
That's wonderful.